What does a practical expedient talk about? The first and the gating question is the rent concession a direct consequence of the COVID pandemic? If that answer is a no, then you do not get any benefits. But if you believe that no, this is a direct consequence of COVID-19, then there is a choice that the entity has. An entity could say, I will ignore the practical expedient available to me, treat it as a lease modification, and go through the entire process of re-estimating whether it's a separate lease or not, adjust the ROU, and so on. Alternatively, it will say, let me take the benefit of the modification. Take the benefit of the modification and apply the practical expedient. So it's a choice that is available. And this, given that it's a choice, also triggers disclosure requirements for preparers of financial statements. But three key requirements to apply this particular choice. Because it's a choice, it comes with riders. There is nothing like a free lunch. Three things to be kept in mind. First one, is the revised consideration substantially the same as that immediately prior to the change? Second key criterion that comes along is that the reduction in payments should only impact payments that are due in the contract on or before 30 June 2021. And the last one, there is no substantive change to other terms and conditions of the lease. Let's now take and spend maybe a few minutes to look at this in a little more detail. Why don't I quickly open up the poll? Okay, we've seen the example and let's now look at what the assessment is. Retail chain X leases several of its stores and the headquarter building. COVID-19 cases were identified in the country in March 2020. The company observed fewer falls and fewer sales. Subsequently, a nationwide lockdown was announced and the company decided that it would have had to close some of its outlets for customers. In January 2020, a rent concession was agreed for the head office building because of the refurbishment that had to happen in the building undertaken by the landlord. The lessee said this is causing inconvenience, and therefore the lessor said, why don't we enter into a reduction in the rentals? Now, the question that we are trying to assess here is, would X be able to apply the practical expedient to head office building, retail outlets, neither of them, both of them, or there is an accounting policy choice? At this stage, friends, we are talking about the gating question. Yeah, we are getting responses. Let's just wait for another few seconds and close this. Okay, interesting responses. So no one believes that the head office building alone is entitled to a concession. However, 13% of the participants believe that there is a choice available to apply to both of them. And interestingly, 13% believe that there is an accounting policy choice to apply to either of them. So interesting results. I think what we are now trying to talk about is the gating question here in this example. Is it a direct consequence of COVID? And this is where the element of judgment comes about. In my judgment, based on the facts that we see here, the rent concession for the head office building is not related to COVID. it is because of a refurbishment activity undertaken by the landlord. So there is no accounting choice available for the office building. The office building is a clear-cut accounting for modification of lease rentals for both the lessor and the lessee. But with respect to the retail outlets, there is judgment that can be applied. And the judgment that can be applied is to say, is this really directly related to COVID? The answer is yes, it is related to COVID. And it is because of the fewer footfalls, because of the lockdown, and the fact that my sales have not happened, that in my judgment, this is direct consequence of COVID. And this is the gating question. If at this stage one says, no, it's not COVID, the rest of the discussion on practical experience is not relevant. But if it is related to COVID, then the rest of the discussion assumes importance. What one would need to do is, frankly speaking, fairly common sense type assessments. Look at when did the renegotiation of the rentals get discussed? Was it way in advance of COVID? Was it after COVID? What does the documentation indicate the reason for the renegotiation? What was the timing of the renegotiation? In many cases, the renegotiation may have happened before the lockdown, for example, but that may have happened because the suppliers for this company were from places where COVID has had a much significant impact before March. And therefore, although the lockdown and COVID was observed in this country in March, it had a direct impact because the supply chain had started getting impacted from December, January onwards. So you could still conclude that, yes, this is a direct consequence of COVID. Alternatively, one could say that, no, this had nothing to do with COVID at all. My impact only started from March. Also, in a lot of cases, lockdown alone is not relevant in the assessment. So one could still say that if the rental gets negotiated after the lifting of the national lockdown, it could still be an impact, or the concession could still have an impact of COVID. And the reason for that is, although the lockdown is lifted, people are still hesitant to come out of their homes. People are practicing social distancing. The number of footfalls that I would have otherwise seen in my retail chain will now drop significantly. All of these could be attributed to be a direct impact of COVID. And that, friends, therefore, would meet the gating condition. Now let's look at the other three criteria that we spoke of in some detail. What are the three criteria? The first one we said is the revised consideration is substantially the same or less than the original consideration. Now this applies only where the lease consideration is substantially same. If the lease consideration is significantly different, then it would not apply. One of the ways in which one could assess this is to say, what is the impact in present value terms? If in present value terms, the new rentals are more or less equivalent or substantially the rentals before the modification, one could conclude that yes, this condition is indeed met. Right. So you could also have a situation where, for example, the lease rental is increased, but that increases only to compensate for change in time value of money. So either the consideration remains the same or it increases, but if it increases, it increases only to compensate for time value of money. A third situation is, as a lessee, I am not doing enough business. I don't have the cash flows to pay the rent at all. Now I unilaterally decide not to pay a rent. That, friends, does not allow me the benefit of the practical expedient because it is not agreed in the contract. So any rent reduction should have been agreed in the contract or should have been specifically agreed in the contract. I don't have the ability to pay rents and therefore I don't pay the rent does not in any way permit me to apply the expedient. Unless both the parties have a contract which says, I understand you have a liquidity problem, I am reducing your lease rental. If that does not happen, friends, then this practical expedient cannot be availed. The other condition that we said or spoke of was that the payments had to be due on or before June 2021. This should be 2021. My apologies for this. The practical expedient really puts in a time bar because it does not want it to be evergreen. The standard setters, no one knows the real impact of when or the real timing of when the pandemic will stop impacting us. But there has to be an end date. So what the standard setters in their wisdom thought, let's put an end date. Let us say that only those payments originally due before 30 June 2021 will be considered in this. Otherwise, one could start structuring contracts to try and take benefit of this guidance, which is what was not required to be applied. So they wanted to prevent any implication of a broader application of this expedient. Direct impact of COVID and only up to 2021. Finally, it could have an impact on comparability. There is no denying that some companies may choose, some could avail the expedient, some may not. Some could choose rent, may even decide at a later point in time that I want to negotiate my rentals, which are impacted by COVID-19. But be that as it may, the idea is to give relief to those who are impacted and to give relief to those who want to avail the relief. And that's why, while there could be some lack of comparability, it is only going to remain for a limited period of time. Another quick example to talk about why the 30 June 2021 is relevant. Lessee X leases an office building from A. As a result of the pandemic, in September 2020, the lessee agreed to reduce the rentals by 50% per month for the next 12 months. Now here, if the assessment is, would the lessee be able to apply the benefit of the lease rental? The answer is no, because we only look at lease rentals originally due up to 30 June 2021. And in this case, there are lease rentals that will be due originally under the contract after 30 June 2021. So for example, the July-August 2021 rentals would be after the cutoff date that is prescribed in the standard. One could also then go ahead and ask as to, can I break this 12 months down into 9 months plus 3 months? But the answer to that is that the standard does not permit that kind of a breakdown. You look at the new term that you have negotiated in its entirety, you do not break it down into 9 plus 3 and then do the assessment. So in this case, the lessee X will not be able to avail the expedient. The last one is condition that we spoke about was one which does involve some amount of judgment as to whether there are any substantive changes. The term substantive changes are not defined in the standard, but a lot of this has to be drawn based on the judgment in the terms and conditions of the standard. So for example, if there are absolutely no other changes to the contract except the term, except the amounts, except the quantum of assets in scope, one could logically conclude that there are no other substantive changes. More importantly, this may not really have too much of a practical implication, because let's keep in mind that there are also two other conditions one would need to satisfy, which is the PV of the new cash flows compared to the PV before the modification on account of COVID. Second, and more importantly, there is a specific time period within which the amounts have to be due originally as per the contract. So given those three overall broad brush parameters that are there, this one is more of a prevention of abuse rather than having a meaningful practical impact. So no practical difficulty expected from this one. Now, having looked at how does one avail the expedient, let's turn our attention to what the practical expedient actually is. We've crossed the gating question, we've crossed the accounting policy choice, and now we are saying, as a lessee, I am willing to avail the amendment. I am willing to apply the amendment. Logically, there could be broadly two types of benefits that one could get from this kind of a negotiation. One is a complete holiday or a complete waiver of rent. Another one is a rent deferral, saying, I understand you don't have the cash now. Please pay me the cash later, but please pay me to either compensate me for time value of money or just pay me the notional amount of cash flows. So rent deferral with or without escalation or time value of money, or waiver of rent. Waiver of rent could either be conditional or it could be unconditional.